Thank you for joining at 8 o'clock. Let's continue our discussion on concurrent data structures. We were looking at a linked list, a single linked list, and we wanted to insert some element into it. Right? And then we figured out that there is some issue while writing that even in between. And since the ordering amongst elements which are inserted in parallel is not really fixed, we could as well think of inserting it at the head, which means that all the nodes or all the threads are inserting their new nodes at the start of the linked list. In the sequential setting, the code looks like this, where let's say there is some new node G2, right? So that new node arrow next is whatever head is pointing to, which could be null, by the way. And then head starts pointing to the new node, right? So this is the code that each thread needs to execute to make sure that it gets inserted at the head in some order. However, doing that in parallel on let's say GPU or CPU, that requires some sort of a lock, and that's what we discussed yesterday. So what kind of lock is going to be helpful? Let's look at that. So one option is to keep a lock associated with the list, which means that whenever you want to modify the list, you take a lock, perform whatever operations you want to do on the list, and then release the lock. That turns out to be a very nice usual critical section problem, and that does solve our issue in the sense that you can update head arbitrarily. It will make sure that multiple nodes, or rather lost update problem, does not occur. Right. So even if there are multiple nodes, all of those are going to get inserted in some order depending upon how the locks are acquired by different threads. So let me list those advantages and issues here. The advantage, so this is actually called as a coarse-grained synchronization, which means that there is a single lock associated with the whole list. And that means that even if you are performing operations at one part of the list could be very large. Even if you are performing operations on one part of the list, you are locking the whole list. And therefore, this is called coarse-grained synchronization. Right? And as you can imagine, that since you are taking a coarse-grained lock, the accesses are essentially going to get sequentialized. And therefore, it is this particular method is going to have a low concurrency, although it is relatively much easier to implement. You just take a lock and put anything that you want to do in the critical section, including you can have a for loop inside the critical section. Sometimes it might be required because let's say that you are trying to insert elements at the end of the list. In such cases, you have to traverse the list, assuming that you don't maintain a tail pointer, in which case you might have a for loop inside a critical section. That is not always a good idea, but in this case, if you require it, it still works and it is okay. Right? But that is going to reduce the concurrency further. It's also important from the theoretical perspective to argue about correctness, that whether the parallel code that I have generated, whether it is going to perform an operation which is going to adhere to the semantics of the concurrent linked list that I have defined, which means that whether the insert operations are going to finish execution properly the way it is expected in a sequential setting, subject to the ordering of the elements, right? So as long as that is there, you can ensure that the correctness is guaranteed. Any other suggestions on this particular way of performing coarse-grained synchronization or inserting elements into the list? Any questions? All right. So then let's modify our coarse grained lock, since we know its disadvantages, that it reduces concurrency. Let's try to increase the concurrency. What does that mean? Increasing the concurrency is that if I want to insert something at the head versus if the list is long and I'm inserting something at somewhere in the middle of the list and then somewhere towards the end of the list, these three operations can typically be done in parallel, right? Because they are not touching the same memory location. Here there is some assumption that you are probably not traversing the list, but maybe if you have traversed and you have found out some pointers, right? These are the places where I want to insert the nodes. Maybe I should be able to insert those nodes at those places in parallel, which is currently not possible with the coarse grained block. So can I improve that by keeping track of a lock at each node in the linked list rather than one coarse grained lock, right? So this we'll call as, what would be a good name for such a locking mechanism? Sure, fine grained lock, right? So we'll call this as fine grained locks. Definitely this is, if you are able to do this, then this has more concurrency, which means that you are going to get better parallelism out of this, better performance. And what is the downside of this?
Too many locks.
Too many locks. But what is the issue with too many locks?
Deadlock.
Some sort of performance issue.
Mm-hmm. Deadlock and performance issue. Okay, let's take one by one. Why, Shira, there would be a deadlock?
Sir, because there is a next pointer, right? Mm-hmm. Like one node will be, suppose if you want to update one node, a lock should be accessed. Then when after you do the update, you need to set the next pointer, right? But mm-hmm. That time maybe another lock will be another lock will be doing the processing in that, so that can't be accessed without the lock is released.
Okay, so maybe the way we have looked at insertion, it might not cause an issue because the new node that we are inserting is a new node, so nobody else knows about it, only the thread which is inserting. That thread only knows about that pointer, so nobody else can access it. And therefore, the two pointers that we are talking about, only one of them is accessible to the threads, whereas this one cannot be accessed. So there are no two resources being accessed by two threads at the same time, and therefore, there is no possibility of deadlock with respect to this part. However, you can imagine that if you want to insert an element at the middle of the list, well, there also you really don't require a lock unless you want to lock the node which is next to. So let's say that there are P and Q nodes which are consecutive and you want to insert something in the middle of that. And you want to maintain that Q should not be modified or should not be moved away or should not be deleted, or some other thread should not insert something in between P and Q while I am inserting. At that time, you might require lock on both P and Q. In such cases, there is a possibility of a deadlock depending upon how you have implemented the fine grained locks. So in general, whenever you require more than one locks, whenever, and coarse grained lock has only single lock, so fine grained lock, since it has multiple locks, there is a possibility of a deadlock. Deletion might require might lead to deadlock because you might be deleting some item and now you want to move the pointer from previous to the next. So you might want to lock the node that is getting deleted as well as the previous node. And therefore, and both these nodes are shared across all the threads, and therefore there is a possibility of a deadlock. So that is possible. The second one that Rigved was pointing out was about, because there are too many locks, will there be any performance degradation? Where does this performance degradation come into play? Any suggestions? That point is correct, but I want to understand where it is coming from.
Sir, if many threads want to insert between many many nodes, mm-hmm. then we have to take many different locks. And nice. Since we know that synchronization is an expensive mechanism, so it will decrease the performance.
I see. Okay. Yeah. So earlier in coarse-grained lock, we were taking a single lock. Now we might have to take, let's say, two or three locks even sometimes. Let's say you are talking about a concurrent tree or graph. You might have to take more number of locks. In such cases, the cost of one insertion can increase. And therefore, you might see degradation in performance is what Rigved's argument is. incidentally, it so happens that yes, the cost of one operation increases, but the number of operations that you can do in parallel, that goes on increasing. And therefore, overall, you will still see a benefit. But the more importantly, if you have more number of locks, there is a possibility of degradation, because many times, not many times, but let me put it this way, that depending upon the library or the mechanism that you are using underneath, operating system might, or not might, operating system is likely to play a role. Let's say you are talking about Java, in which maybe the operating system will not do much. It's going to be the JVM which is going to do that. But in, let's say, other cases, or even in case of JVM, when we are talking about JVM itself as some sense operating system, which is keeping track of all these locks, etc., the number of locks is going to increase the memory footprint. And not only memory footprint, the way you are accessing locks, that is going to have, in some sense, some sort of an access pattern. And that access pattern will create issues. The second thing is those memory locations sometimes requires operating system support, in the sense that some of those locks might be held, or the processing of, or the metadata corresponding to those locks might be held in the system area. And that is the kernel space. And that can increase the footprint. In fact, in some of the earlier operating systems, we used to have a limit on the number of locks that could be given to a particular process. Nowadays, it has almost become like a memory location. So number of logical locks turns out to be pretty large. So that limit is practically infinite. But that used to be the case, that there used to be a bound on the number of locks which could be held by a process. And performance was definitely one concern, but the overall memory usage was another concern which used to play a role. Okay, so that sounds good. There are other issues. For example, the locks, the way we implement locks, right? So we have some sort of atomic, some sort of volatile variability, in the sense that the variables that are involved are volatile. And therefore, there is a cost associated with implementation of more and more locks as they increase, the more and more volatile variables, and therefore more transactions with the last level cache or memory. And therefore, the cost will also go on increasing. Just that you have better concurrency. So the throughput is going to be better, but the latency for one particular, if I may call it latency of, or execution time of one particular lock will probably be increased, or the cost will increase, but the number of transactions, number of lock operations that can happen in parallel will improve, which improves the throughput. Okay, so that is one disadvantage, but there is another disadvantage similar to what we discussed about the coarse grained lock. What could that be? Okay, so one thing which we talked about coarse-grained lock is that it is easier to argue about correctness. That becomes involved when you have lots of different locks. Since you are talking about that, okay, I'm going to take lock on the previous one, then the next one, and then I'm going to set the pointers. Whether you are doing it in the same manner across all threads, or whether you are trying to do something that I'm going to order the nodes based on some node ID or the data, and depending upon that, I'm taking a log because I want to avoid deadlocks. Then if the deadlocks do not happen, maybe is there a possibility of a live lock? So all of these issues start coming into play when we are dealing with multiple locks. And therefore, the arguing for correctness turns out to be a little more complicated compared to that in coarse-grained lock, right? So these are the disadvantages of this. So better concurrency. It's also difficult to implement, in the sense that we need to worry about exact set of the semantics of the operations that are supported. Like we said, in sequential setting, it is okay. If you insert an element at the start of the list, we know that the order of the elements is going to be opposite of what gets inserted. But in case of parallelism, we cannot say so. I mean, although everybody is inserting at the start of the list, the ordering could be arbitrary. And therefore, we cannot always talk about that if the input is like this, then the output is going to be like this. Output could be a range of options. Output could be a set of options. And therefore, we need to mention what is the meaning of a particular operation. So if there are multiple operations, insert operations happening at the same time, what can happen? In this case, we said that the ordering doesn't matter. If insert and delete are happening at the same time, what does that mean? Like we discussed last time, if insert happens first and then let's say deletion happens, the deletion will succeed. But if the deletion happens first for a particular element and then the insert of the same element, the deletion might return an error that the element doesn't exist, right? So the ordering starts coming into play. Similar thing happens with insert versus search, for example, or search versus delete. And these are very common operations across all data structures, not necessarily only about the concurrent list. So we need to define what are the supported operations for them. Sometimes the sequential operations, which make sense, or the semantics of them might not be applicable in the context of the parallel setting. So we need to think about it. So that creates a little bit of design complexity while creating this concurrent linked list. And finally, the arguing about the correctness becomes a little more involved. Right? In fact, although it is not part of this course, there is a nice theory of, let's say, linearizability, using which we will be able to say that a particular operation is linear, a particular set of operations are linearizable. And using that, we sometimes prove that a certain operation behaves in a particular manner as intended. All right. So if we have to take a lock like this, now can you write a code corresponding to a fine-grained lock? So you assume that there is a lock associated with each node, and I still am interested in inserting elements at the head. So head is a pointer which is pointing to the first node in the list. And for now, to make your life simple, you can assume that there exists some nodes in the list. Its head is not null. And let's see if you are able to do that. Meanwhile, I'll take Aditya's question. If we are only restricting to insert elements from one position, if we are following this strict order of inserting the elements, is coarse-grained lock better in this case? That's a good point. In this case, it will so happen that if you are restricting to only updating the head, both coarse as well as the fine-grained lock will have almost the same performance. The reason being that you are most probably going to have the same critical section, whether you take a coarse-grained lock or fine-grained lock, right? So the cost of locking one node is going to be the same in both cases. And therefore, you will have almost okay, so please work on implementing this insertion using some sort of fine-grained locks, and let's see if we can discuss some of those answers. So you can assume that there is a lock and unlock function available with each node, let's say, which means that if there is a pointer pointing to a particular node, let's say PTR, PTR arrow lock will lock that particular node, PTR arrow unlock will unlock. So that you can assume. And how to implement that lock that we have seen. So don't worry about that for now. And if you are facing some issue in implementing it, feel free to ask. Okay, so I'm assuming that you are trying and you are taking time. Okay, I'll move ahead from here. One thing that you should check if you have tried inserting it is that if you have more than one insertions happening at the same time, whether you are getting the expected output. So sometimes we feel that going from the sequential setting, because our mind is sequential, so it's natural that it thinks in a sequential manner. So the way we write the code might work out for one insertion, but might not work out when there are more than one. And therefore, that is a good check to just see if multiple insertions are happening at the same time correctly. Correctly meaning in some order. Okay, so let's try with some code that I have written. Right. So that's what I was mentioning, that check if two concurrent inserts are working in your code if you have written that. So let's say that, okay, so I'm showing the example of where the issue could occur, right? This is something which we have discussed last time. If there is some thread which wants to insert G, and here I'm inserting at arbitrary location, not necessarily at the head, but the same issue appears at the head too. G and H, if I insert, according to our sequential code, G dot next is done by T1, which is pointing to P, and then H dot next is also pointing to P according to T2. And then we say that P arrow next should either be pointing to G, that is done by T1, and pointing to H, which is done by T2, and one of them happens. Hopefully one of them happens, by the way. And therefore, we have lost update problem in the sense that one of the two, either G or H, will not be in the linked list, which is starting from, let's say, the head here. So you will get either GP GPU or you will get GP HPU, but you will not get GP GHPU or GP HGPU. Right? So we require 6 nodes, but you might just see 5 accessible from the head. Although that memory location is allocated, that pointer does exist in memory, just that it is not accessible from the head. So that's the our lost update problem. And the same thing will happen with the head. So you can assume that this P is actually the head. So head will start pointing to either H or G after they have updated their next pointers pointing to P. And this occurs because we have to make both these updates as both these statements as critical section, in the sense that updating the next pointer of G or H and updating head needs to be in the critical section. That was possible for coarse grained lock, right? Or if you just have some lock, right? So that was okay for a coarse grained lock. Now the issue is that there are two locks that I need to take. And somehow I have to make sure that that ordering happens properly, right? So I should not update head by the time the next update happens, right? So Rigveda has written a code while atomic gas lock of a particular node not equal to ID, I'm going to wait. So that is my lock instruction on that particular position, which is the that particular node. And then that particular node arrow next equal to head and head equal to N, and atomic gas this where pause is the position where we want it to insert.
Sir, I have used head here because I am assuming position is equal to zero. I am inserting at head.
I see.
Sir, so in this code, we can define position and it will lock only those node where we want to insert. Like in this case, we want to insert between P and P, so it will lock P. But if we want to insert after U, then other thread can insert because lock of U will not be locked. So it will be some type of fine grain lock.
I see. Okay, so let's analyze this code before we look at the code that I'm going to write. So we are taking a lock on that particular position where we want to insert, and the position is decided by the previous pointer to which whose next is going to get updated. Is that correct, Digvik?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So in this case, let's say that we are talking about. Okay, let's think in the context of head itself. So N arrow next is head. So we have, let's say, taken a lock on head. And if you have taken a lock on head, then nobody else can take the lock. So that will work out. If this is some other node, then we'll have to probably change that statement N arrow next equal to that particular node, let's say position. And then that position arrow next is going to be N. That seems to be okay to me. Just that as far as inserting at the head is concerned, which is what this code is doing. Yeah, there is a single lock. So this is similar to saying this head dot lock or head arrow lock, then N arrow next equal to head and head equal to N, and then head arrow unlock, or maybe the previous pointer arrow unlock, right? So that's what this code looks like. Okay. It looks okay to me, but anybody sees any issues with this code? So I'm just going to rewrite it. Okay, Arihant has written a code. Yeah, I'll come to Arihant's code. And then N arrow next equal to head equal to head equal to N, N arrow next. So I'm just trying to rewrite Rigved's code. Rigved, you can confirm if this is what you intended. Head arrow lock. So assuming that head is pointing to a valid memory location. So I lock the head. I don't need to lock N because that is anyway a new node, not accessible to the others. And then N arrow next becomes head. That is, it is pointing to whatever head is pointing to. And then head needs to change to this new node. But as soon as head changes, I have lost track of what head was pointing to. But then I know that from N arrow next. So I'm going to unlock that using N arrow next. So that is the last part, N arrow next arrow unlock. Does that seem reasonable, or somebody sees any issues with this apart from the null pointer if head is pointing to null? Okay, so that seems to be probably all right, but let's see if somebody finds out something. Let's look at Arihant's code. PTR equal to head, previous equal to null, while not of PTR arrow lock. Okay, so PTR arrow lock is probably returning 0 or 1. Previous equal to PTR equal to PTR arrow list. Okay, fine. PTR equals null, that is you have reached the end. Then PTR equal to head, previous equal to null. Okay. Okay, so you are getting essentially the previous pointer and the probably the pointer that you require. And then G arrow next equal to PTR. G I suppose is, okay, that's the new pointer. G arrow next equal to PTR, and if previous not equal to null, then head equal to G, otherwise previous arrow next equal to G. PTR arrow unlock. Arihant, I didn't understand the meaning of this not of PTR arrow lock. Is it that you are trying to lock every node as you go along? Or are you just checking if it is not if it has not been locked? Oh, it should be previous equals equals. Yeah, so that part is fine. The if condition is fine after the while loop. But first find first node which is not locked. I see. So the semantics is that you are going over the list and you are finding out the node which is not unlocked, which is not locked, and you are trying to insert there so that your concurrency is going to be better. Otherwise you will be stuck. So that's an important point from the perspective of concurrent data structures, that many times in case of linked lists we start from the head, and therefore if you are inserting at the head or even at the tail, that part becomes a bottleneck. When we are trying from the perspective of a tree, we start from the root. And if you have to acquire a lock on the root to go either to the left or the right, that can also become a bottleneck. So the upper part of the tree or the earlier part of the list can become a performance bottleneck. So what Arihant's code is trying to do is that since ordering of elements doesn't matter, you don't hold yourself if head is locked. You go ahead and see if there is some node which is unlocked and go insert there. So that increases concurrency. So that's a good point. Yeah, one issue that I see is that by the time you try updating the PTR, PTR might have been locked. So PTR arrow lock is, so it is not locked by the time you check. And then by the time you come out of the while loop to G arrow next equal to PTR, by then it has been locked by somebody else. But where is PTR arrow lock then? So I'm assuming that you will have PTR arrow lock somewhere. And that condition check, that PTR arrow lock in the while condition, that and the place where PTR arrow lock happens, if these two instructions are separate, then there is a possibility of some issue that it might get locked by the time you reach there, in which case you will have to wait. Yeah, so that might be okay. You might get blocked if you have the lock instruction, let's say, outside the while loop, so you will block there, which is okay, which is better than getting blocked on the head. Okay, so that seems to be all right to me. Any other suggestions, any other concerns here?
Sir, in your code, sir, first we are locking head, then we are executing next is equal to head, and then we are executing head is equal to nn next. Sir, but when we are executing the third statement, we are reassigning head. So
Right.
now it will not have lock on it.
That's a good point. That's a very good point.
So before our thread comes out of unlock, we are still in critical section, but other thread can still enter in critical section.
That is correct. So there is a possibility that this critical section is, I mean, this is not really going to be taken as a critical section because we are updating head as the third statement, head equal to n. So I'm talking about the statement which I have written, the four statements that I have written as a follow-up of Rigved's code. So Rigved has pointed out that head equal to n is going to be changing the shared memory location head, which means that as soon as that happens and before this thread comes out of the this sort of critical section or its code, some other thread will have access to head. So isn't it possible that that is going to cause any issue? So definitely there is some interleaving that is possible. Let's see if that is dangerous or not. Right? So what we have done so far is that I have locked head node, that is some node. I have not locked the new node that I'm inserting, but new node's next pointer is pointing to where head was pointing to. So that is okay. And now I have updated the head, right? This is the place I am at. I have not removed the lock onto the n arrow next, which means that whatever was the original head, that lock I have not removed. So there is a previous node which I have inserted to head. That previous is pointing to the earlier head, which is the now the second node. So that second node is locked, the first node is not locked, and head is now pointing here. Right? So that is the state we are in. Now, if a thread starts traversing this using the head, the new head, what it will do is that it will try to insert, it will try to lock this new head, etc. That is not really going to cause an issue because there is no update we are doing with respect to the second node. So as far as insertions are concerned, that is not going to cause any issue because everything is going to happen before this. At some point in time, our thread which had executed this code will unlock this node, which earlier was second. Now it is probably going to be third, fourth, fifth, etc. The other issue that can happen is that if you have operations other than insert, let's say I'm searching or I'm deleting, etc. And I don't need to take a lock, then the code will work just as it is. Right? For example, search might just work as it is because it will look for this node and it will find it and so on. If there is a deletion or there is some update that you want to do across the links, at that time I might be required to take a lock on this n arrow next. This lock is not going to go through unless our previous thread has unlocked it. Right? But that is okay. It is not going to cause any issue with respect to the correctness of the procedure. So although there is some sort of interleaving happening, I don't see any problem with respect to doing that. But that's a very good point that we should be definitely worried about. Rigved, does that logic seem reasonable?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Anybody sees any other issues, or even in this argument, does anybody see any issue? If somebody has not understood the discussion, please feel free to ask. We can go over that a little more. Siddharth Sai, you are able to follow? Sai Chaitanya?
Sir, can you repeat that part of the logic again?
Yeah, I'll repeat that. So let's look at this code. I mean, the one that I have printed, the four lines at 8:30 a.m. Head arrow lock, then n arrow next equal to head, head equal to n, and n arrow next arrow unlock. Right. So this code we are going to execute to make sure that we insert a new element which is being pointed to by the pointer n into a singly linked list which is currently being accessed via head. Head is a shared variable across threads, right? Now let's, the argument that we had was that if I change head equal to n in the third statement, and this particular thread which is executing head equal to n, which is the one which is inserting this new node n, it has not executed the fourth statement, which is unlocking this node, right? So we had a linked list which was 2, 3, 4. This new node contains the value 1. That new node 1 arrow next is pointing to 2. And I have not done 2 dot unlock, right? So n arrow next, that is 1 arrow next is 2, and 2 arrow unlock I have not done. So now the linked list is 1, 2, 3, 4. I have updated the head to point to 1, right? So from 2, 3, 4, the linked list has become 1, 2, 3, 4. But I have locked still 2. Now when a new thread comes and tries to traverse this, it will actually see 1, 2, 3, 4. So assuming that search doesn't require locking, it will just go ahead and search for 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. And it will perform some operation, return the pointers, etc. If there is some insertion happening, let's say I'm inserting 0, that is going to lock 1, which is currently unlocked, and it will insert 0 arrow next equal to 1, and then head it will update from 1 to 0 and so on. So now the list will become 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. 2 is still locked. That's possible. If there is deletion, I might have want to lock 1 and 2, let's say. If I want to delete, let's say, 2, then I need to update 1 pointing to 3, right? So there is a delete operation from some other thing. Now when I come to lock 1, that is, let's say, unlocked, so I lock it. Now I want to lock 2 also, but 2 is still locked by our previous thread, which had done this operation into the chat box. So eventually, so that particular thread which wants to do the deletion, that is going to get blocked. Eventually, this thread will perform its unlock and release this, and then that deletion thread is going to get that lock on 2. So it has lock on 1, it has lock on 2, then it performs the deletion, it will go ahead. So this unlock might get delayed, but thankfully it is not causing any issues with respect to the semantics of the various operations, depending upon how those are. Right. So as far as our usual operations are concerned, that is not getting those are not getting affected. But this is very important to understand what Rigved has pointed out, that I am updating a shared pointer and I am not coming out of the critical section. So that effect is still visible to the other threads, and therefore you should be careful about that. It's just that we are lucky in this case, but otherwise this could have caused some issue. Right. For example, if I reorder these two statements, head equal to n, and n arrow next equal to, no, I can't do that because I'll have to save the head pointer. But anyway, so if there were more such statements and I reorder them, in typically critical section, if you reorder, it's not going to cause any issue because no other thread is accessing those shared variables. But in this case, the head itself is changing. So I have locked the node which the head is pointing to, but I have not locked head as such. If there would have been a lock on the using of head itself, then this would have probably worked out in the sense that it would have become very similar to our usual critical section. Okay, any other concerns here? Sure, Saishi. All right, so if there are no further questions, then I'll show you some code, right? So this is the code that I have written, which is, I think, the same as I have, just a small mistake in this, but otherwise there is the code is, the logic is the same, right? So I want to insert a new node. I'm just calling it Naya, and then I lock the head. Naya arrow next starts pointing to the head, and then head starts pointing to the Naya, that is the n variable in this, and then I do the unlock, right? So this is the mistake that I'm doing here, right? And that is that the head has actually changed. So I should not do, although I have done head dot lock, I should not do head dot unlock or head arrow unlock. I need to unlock the appropriate one. So what I'm going to do is PTR equal to head, right? So that is one way in which I'm going to, so I'm just showing you different variations that we usually come up with, although we have the correct variation in the chat box. So I store that pointer, that head pointer into some local variable PTR, and I do PTR arrow lock and then PTR arrow unlock. So that will make sure that I am using the right node to be updated, and then the rest of the code remains the same. Right? Does this code look all right? Any issues with this? Kshitij, do you see any issues with this? Shashidhar?
Sir, between PTR equal to head and PTR lock, some other thread could insert at head, right? So yeah, it will essentially not be locking head, it will be locking some other node.
Correct. So what Niranjan is talking about is that you have done PTR equal to head here, right? But there is no guarantee that after this head doesn't change. Maybe some other thread comes, it inserts its own node, and therefore head has changed. I'm still pointing to that old node. Logically, it might not cause an issue because we said that insertions can happen in any order and so on. But we would like to have as much adherence to the semantics as possible, which meant that we should probably try to insert it at the head. So your intention, I mean, if your intention was that, okay, I have written this code and it works according to the semantics of the linked list, then it is okay. But if your intention is that, oh, this is always going to insert at the head and head is going to get updated, then your code is not matching the intention. And therefore, there is a bug. Right? Although practically, you will not see it as a bug. Right? So there is a danger here that by the time PTR arrow lock happens, head may have changed, and therefore, you might actually create, you may not see a problem, but in this case, let's see. So head, so I'm going to lock something else, narrow next equal to head, which might be a different memory location, okay. And then head equal to naya, that is also okay. PTR arrow unlock, that is also okay. So in this case, it according to our semantics of reordering different nodes, this is not really going to cause any issue. But remember that this is not what we intended to do, right? And therefore there could be a lurking bug in such a code. That, does that seem reasonable, Kshitij?
Okay, sir.
Sure. Any other issues with this code? Okay. So let's.
Then what if here, if the even if PTR arrow lock changes like the even if head changes, there will not be any problem, right? Because it will wait till the next time. Okay. I get it. We will not have that.
Yeah. So if let's say head changes after this statement, so PTR is probably pointing to the current. Let's say G here, right? And then I'm going to lock this. But before I try to lock, this thread tries to lock this G, some other thread has inserted some element here and head is now pointing to that particular node, right? So let's see what happens. So this naya arrow next, so naya is some node which I'm trying to insert, let's say this one, that starts pointing here. Right, because not here. Sorry. Is there,
sir,
an undo?
Suppose we do this, and head changes. Then there's essentially no point in holding the lock for PTR, right? Because that is some obsolete node. We can hold her, but ultimately we're not referencing that PTR anywhere inside the critical.
That is correct. That is also, I mean, that is also semantically an incorrect thing to do. So let me put it this way, that this particular new node that is getting, currently I'm just trying to see if this code is causing any other issue. Just so naya arrow next, that is this naya is this G, let's say, that is now pointing to the previous head, the new head, and head starts pointing to naya. So head now, which was pointing here, is now pointing to this node. And then PTR arrow unlock, right? So this PTR, which is not coming into picture at all, that is getting locked as well as unlocked. And that is not really causing any issues with this, right? So thankfully this works out, but it's not guaranteed that it will work out. Any other concerns here?
Sir, will there be multiple heads?
No, head is a variable, and it's a primitive variable of type some, let's say, node star, and therefore head will always have one value at any point in time.
The value, but it can be, but it can be any value, but it will be always one. Okay.
Yeah. So we'll assume that it is a single pointer which gets updated atomically. Yeah. So that's also a good point. This head equal to naya, since it is a primitive type, pointer is usually, let's say, 32 or 64 bits, to which the assignment is atomic by the hardware itself. And therefore, we'll assume that this assignment is atomic. If it is not, then there is a problem. Then we might require a lock even for updating the head. That's a good point. We are assuming in some sense here, similar to what we had done when we did data and control flow, that the updates to, let's say, flag or other, right? So those were atomic in nature. Similarly, we'll have to assume that it is atomic. Otherwise, we need a lock even for that. Any other concerns here?
Sir, here is a data race, right? In between this fourth statement and fifth statement. Like, since we are, in the fourth statement, we are reading from head, and fifth statement, we are writing to head.
In fourth statement, we are reading, writing to head. In the fifth statement, we are...
I'm not sure what it was.
So is naya arrow next and head, is it?
Yes, sir. Yeah, because the lock is not held of head, right? It's of pointer. PTR is the lock that we are holding, but head is somewhere else, and someone else is holding the head, a lock to the head, let's say. And if you update head directly without acquiring the lock of the current head, wherever that is.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's a valid point. I'll tell you what's happening. Head is a memory location. I'm not locking this head. So what I was trying to convey is that if there is some update which I need to block for updating the head pointer itself, then I need a lock on the head. But currently, when I say head arrow lock, I'm actually locking the node which is being pointed to by head. So head is here, this node is here, head has address of that. When I say head arrow lock, I'm locking this node. Head is just a pointer, and pointer doesn't have any lock associated with it. Only the nodes have, only the structure has, right? And therefore, we will, if you have to, in some other semantics, if you have to update, for example, if there is a doubly linked list, which requires both head and tail to be updated together, then I will require some sort of lock corresponding to this common data structure, which is going beyond a single pointer, beyond a primitive type, and therefore we will require a lock for this logical one step update which involves two steps, right? But in this case, when I say head arrow lock, I'm locking the node, not the head, and therefore you are free to update the head. I don't know if I made that point clear, but
We had some network issue. Can you repeat it? I could not hear.
Yeah, so I'll just repeat it. Those who have classes, feel free to go ahead. When I'm trying to lock head arrow lock, right? So that is the statement if I have. Head is a pointer, but it is pointing to some node, right? The lock is held inside the node, inside the structure. Pointers do not have a lock associated with them. So when I say head arrow lock, I am locking this structure. Head is free. So somebody, some other thread can update head and it will start pointing to some other node. That node can be locked again with head arrow lock, but head per se is free. But still, updates to head are turning out to be okay in this case, because there is no data race. Why is there no data race for head? Is because it's a primitive type. It's 32 or 64 bit, and updates to it are automatically atomic as supported by the hardware. And therefore, I don't see any issues with respect to updating of the head and reading of head by some other thread. In this case. In general, however, if you have some other data structure which is creating, so head is in some sense representing the metadata of the linked list. If I have head and tail for a doubly linked list, and I would like to update those in sync, I don't have an atomic instruction to update both of those in the single instruction. Then I require two different instructions, one to update head, another to update tail. If that is not atomic, I might update head via some other thread, and I might update tail via some other thread. And that can be inconsistent with respect to the overall semantics of the doubly linked list. So there we have to worry. In this case, it so happens that I am lucky that since it's a single variable, but there is no lock associated with the head. If there is some reason why you want to have a lock associated with the head, you need a separate lock. Let's say head lock. And then I need to take headlock. Only if headlock is taken, then I can update head. If that is the case, then that requires a different kind of code. Currently, head is free because it's only a pointer.
Sir, here, if in that case, since here in the third lane, we are reading from head, and in fourth lane, we are writing to head, the problem will come when two threads are doing this simultaneously. Like which one will be, like, we cannot say the deterministic output, right? Like this will be first and this will be second. It can happen both ways, right?
Okay, let's check that. So Naya arrow next is being done, let's say, by two threads, and they both are pointing to the current memory location of head, and head equal to Naya happens, and if this update happens in some order, then you are again back to the issue. Yes, you are right. You are right. Yeah, so this code seems to have multiple problems. Yes, you are right. So the head, since I have not locked head might get updated by two threads. Yes, so we are again back to the same issue that we had mentioned here. That is correct. That is correct. Any other issues with this code?
Sir, can you please repeat this statement?
I'll just repeat that. So let me remove this ink from here. So if you look at these two statements, I am reading as well as writing to head. So what can happen is that I have taken a lock on PTR. PTR is the previous value of head. Let's say, so this is probably not the, so for now assume that this G is getting inserted here at the start, and H is also wanting to getting inserted at the head, and head is pointing here, right, to this first G. Right, I'll call this as G1 and this as G2. So let's see how this code is going to perform if there is an issue. So I'm going to one thread, let's say T1, is going to do PTR equal to head. So there is some local variable PTR in which I'm going to start pointing to G1. PTR arrow lock, which means that I'm going to lock G1. That is, T1 is going to lock G1. Now, Naya arrow next, which is G2. Arrow next equal to head. So G2 starts pointing to G1. At this stage, there is a context switch, right? And then another thread, which is T2, that says PTR equal to head. Oh, I see. But PTR equal to head and PTR arrow lock will not go through. because the PTR arrow lock will try to lock G1 because head is still pointing to G1.
Sir, it's the case when first thread has the lock and second and third threads are trying to insert. Like all the three threads have PTR equal to head initially. Mm-hmm. And then one of the three threads can get the lock, and the other two threads will not get the lock, and they will go ahead. Like other two threads will get the lock for the.
Yeah, but the head has not changed yet. Right, head is changing in the fourth line, so head is still pointing to that G1.
Yeah. I'm saying, after the first thread finishes the. Of the thread which has the lock finishes the execution.
I see. So then the head has already changed, but you have the pointer to the previous one. Is that the issue?
Sir.
Yeah, so that is a danger, definitely. Right. So by the time, so that's what we said, that by the time PTR arrow lock happens, head may have changed. So that issue exists. But is there any other issue that I was referring to? So see, all of them have this local variable having PTR, right, which is pointing to the old value of head. And using that, I'm going to do lock and unlock. But by the time you reach PTR arrow lock, head might have changed by some other thread, right, according to the same code. And therefore, by the time, let's say, T1 tries to lock this G1, well, that is okay, but head has probably changed here, pointing to some other node, and there could be actually arbitrary set of nodes which might have come in between. Just that according to the semantics, this is not causing an issue, but otherwise there is it is not matching what we intended to.
No, sir. So suppose we have this arbitrary number of nodes in between.
Okay.
And then let's say the first thread that already had the lock in the beginning. The first thread that took the lock, does head equal to Maya?
Okay.
So the head comes back all the way to the first node that was trying to insert the Maya, right? So all those nodes that have been added before, we lose the reference.
Okay. Head equal to Maya is being done much later. I see.
Yeah.
I see. That's what you are doing. I see. Okay. Yeah, that makes sense. Yes. So there is another issue here. Yes, you are right. So whatever I said, that it's not matching the intended thing, it's actually more dangerous than that. Okay, I understand. So what's happening is that you have done up to this part by the initial thread, and the fourth line is not yet executed by the thread. So you have inserted all these nodes. So head has changed. So that is definitely one problem. But the other problem is that now you are going to, this particular thread is going to do head equal to Naya. And therefore, you will start head pointing to this particular pointer, which is G2, and all these earlier pointers which were inserted in parallel, those are going to get lost. So there is a lost update problem here also. That's correct. You're right. I missed that point. Yes, that is correct. Any other issues with this code? Okay, so we'll stop here and we'll look at the correct code maybe tomorrow. Or whatever is the next class. Okay, see you.